12 options to sense the surface of a 3D printer's bed, 12 solutions to the same problem, 12 sensors that are all different. But there can only be one. Well, actually, each one of these has an upside, so let's see what they can and can't do. Myth-busting, 3D printing style. Essentially, these should all do the same thing. When using auto-leveling on a 3D printer or even on other machines that need their workpiece to be at a perfect distance from the tool, like a PCB router, these sensors probe a few different points on the surface and then compensate for any misalignment of the bed or workpiece. Since the sensor itself is the only input the machine gets about how the surface is aligned or deformed, it's kind of critical that it senses stuff reliably and can even detect your surface. The easiest option are inductive sensors, but those only detect metals and are useless for glass. Then you've got optical ones, which can detect any surface as long as it's not totally transparent, mechanical ones that physically extend to the surface and touch it, and lastly capacitive sensors that will detect every surface and then some. To test the repeatability, I built this assembly that should provide a near-perfect linear motion for testing the sensors. Essentially, it's an Egos W rail, which as a sliding mate should have a better repeatability than ball bearings, and the backlash these typically have doesn't matter much since gravity is essentially pre-tensioning things here. Then we've got another Egos part, a 2mm pitch trapezoid spindle attached to a 0.9 degree stepper motor. The two shafts here are touching inside the coupling, so we're not getting any springiness. Again, to take care of any tipping effects of the rail, it's mounted off center. The entire thing is driven with an MKS Gen board that was literally sitting in the scrap bin and a few lines of Arduino code. And yes, you can still run Arduino code by itself on any 3D printer board that would otherwise run the Marlin firmware or similar. All it does is to run the sensor into the surface, backs up a bit, and then does that again 41 more times. In the end, it reports the standard deviation of all measurements, which essentially tells us what sort of precision we can expect from each sensor. To check that this construction even worked as intended, I mounted a steel rod to the carriage and let it close a circuit as it touched the aluminum block, and that came in with a repeatability much better than 1 micron, and basically, it was never further off than a single microstep. Yes, the microstepping might not be perfect, but it's still an indicator that this apparatus works pretty darn well for these measurements. So, the units I've got lined up here are 4 different industrial inductive sensors. The smaller 2mm trigger distance 5V type, a 4mm and an 8mm type, and the Prusa Pinda probe, and yes, Prusa definitely has the smallest and shortest one of them all. Also in the category of the inductive sensors is the one from the BQ Hephaestus 2, but that one turned out to be defective so I couldn't include it. The capacitive ones are also industrial types with 8 and 20mm sensing distances. This huge guy was actually pretty expensive in comparison at around 8 bucks, and even worse, it also didn't work, which was a bummer. Mechanical probes are the BL Touch and a standard micro switch with and without the lever. The BL Touch retracts on its own, while a switch like this will need some sort of servo to lift it up, which will introduce inaccuracies on top of what the sensor itself can do. And lastly, the optical sensors are David Crocker's infrared probe that I got from Think3D Print3D, and a sharp sensor that outputs an analog voltage according to how far away it senses an object, which is really cool, but needs a comparator to generate that on-off signal the board requires. So that's how we're gonna do it. Let's get to myth busting. Number 1, optical sensors can sense plain glass. That's actually one that's a bit more complex than it might look at first sight. Glass is transparent, obviously, at least to the naked eye, but because these sensors work with infrared light, what they see could be completely different to what we see. These sensors work based on reflected light, so having a surface that is this glossy could throw them off as well. Now, the simple answer to the initial question is yes. Both the optical sensors can detect that sheet of glass. David Crocker's sensor easily detects the glass, but the sharp sensor gets thrown off track quite a bit. First of all, it requires a much larger distance to trigger at all, and even then it started drifting and eventually smashed into the glass. The custom sensor did trigger reliably against glass, but still came with a huge penalty in precision. The readings onto glass had a tolerance 15 times as large as the ones onto an opaque block. So while it works, it's not something that is really advisable. Number 2, You can't just run a standard 6 to 36 volt probe from 5 volt. Okay, this one is actually pretty easy to test out. Out of all these 6 to 36 volt probes, none worked on 5 volt except the 8 millimeter capacitive one. And even then, it was much less sensitive than on 12 volt and only triggered against metal parts, while with the higher supply voltage and a voltage divider on the output, it reliably also triggered against printed parts and had a larger trigger distance than on 5 volt. So that one is busted. Number 3. Capacitive probes are unreliable. So the theory with capacitive probes is that they sense pretty much anything. Plastic, glass, wood, metal, humans, etc. The problem is, things like moisture in the air also influence the reading, in theory. So, as a really simple test, I let the system do 21 probes and then just started breathing over the sensor. And oh boy, did that throw it off. Almost instantly, it started triggering about 200 micron earlier. That is 0.2 millimeters, so basically a full layer height off target. So even if you had a less extreme humidity change, it would still throw off the sensor by a significant amount. I also did the same with the inductive sensors, and while they did show a marginal change, it was always in the single digit micron range, which might as well have been from thermal expansion. Speaking of the topic, the capacitive sensor also showed by far the greatest deviation when blasted with a hairdryer on the low setting. So are capacitive sensors unreliable and imprecise? Well, if you look at the base reading in a consistent environment, they aren't that bad. But as soon as anything changes, you will run into issues. Number 4. Probing slower gets you better readings. There are a few things that go into this. First off, some sensors like the sharp one only take a reading a few times per second. So by the time they trigger, you might already be past the point that would be the perfect spot. The same thing might be true for the printer's firmware, which only reads values every now and then. The code I'm using here is checking the sensor after every microstep, so that shouldn't be an issue. But sensor delay, etc. still is. So every sensor was tested at two different speeds, 1.35 millimeters a second and twice as fast at 2.7 millimeters a second, which is about the range you would expect a normal Z-axis to move at. And basically every single sensor was less precise when run at the faster speed. They all showed about 20% better repeatability at the slower speed, some a bit less, some a bit more, so while that's not going to turn a great sensor into an unusable one, or vice versa, it's still a considerable improvement if you just need that extra bit of precision. Number 5. Sensors drift with heat. So you might have noticed the effect that when you run the auto-leveling cycle with the bed cold, the nozzle height will end up slightly different than when probed hot. And this is a very real effect, but after testing all the relevant sensors, I'm not quite sure the sensors themselves are actually the problem here. It looks like the larger the trigger distance is, the larger the temperature drift is going to be. The inductive and optical ones were all decent, maybe not the 8mm inductive one, but the others are all at least usable when heated up. Though what also played into this was that the apparatus slightly heated and expanded too, so the measured trigger distance unavoidably moved back too. What could also play into this is that at higher temperatures, copper and aluminum are less conductive, so for the sensor, it's as if there was a thinner sheet of material, which shortens the trigger distance as well. Number 6. Just use aluminum tape for inductive sensors. So the myth is that if you want all the advantages of an inductive sensor, you can simply use some aluminum tape, even on the bottom of a glass sheet, and the sensor will still trigger. So I used some standard aluminum tape, and the 4 and 8 millimeter inductive sensors do trigger against the roll of material, but none of the inductive sensors actually triggered against one layer of tape, even on the top surface of a glass sheet. So while multiple layers might work, they are going to add some thickness, and even then, you're only going to get a fraction of the nominal trigger distance. And that leads us into number 7. Larger trigger distance sensors are less precise. Well, none of the industrial sensors are actually made to detect a set distance precisely each time. They still can be incredibly good at it. For the inductive sensors, I had 2, 4, and 8 millimeter types, and they all performed virtually identical. They all achieved submicron repeatabilities, except for the 5 volt 2 millimeter one, and even that one was better than 2 micrometers. So that's busted. Number 8. Inductive sensors trigger much closer when sensing aluminum. Instead of trying to explain why this is the case and end up with half the viewers getting bored and the other half roasting me for getting it wrong, let's just stick to the fact. Yes, inductive sensors do lose quite a bit of their trigger distance even against a solid block of aluminum. The distance on the sensor's label is against iron or steel, and with aluminum, you get about half of that. Capacitive sensors aren't affected by this. And lastly, number 9. Any sensor with a standard deviation better than 50 micron is probably good enough. And this is from the BL Touch Kickstarter campaign. This sensor measured in with a standard deviation of about 2.5 micron. Let's take a step back and look at what standard deviation even means in this context. Say you have a bunch of measurements and you plot out how many of them are how far off. Typically, noisy sensors show a normal distribution, which looks like this. All the standard deviation says is that about 2/3 of the measurements are better than that standard deviation range. So with a bed leveling approach that uses just 3 points on average, 2 of them will be measured more precisely than the standard deviation, and 1 of them will be worse. In turn, this point then again has about 2/3 of a chance of falling within the range of 2 standard deviations, which means that statistically every 3 prints that 50 micron sensor is going to be off by more than plus minus 100 micron or 0.1 millimeters. And if you've ever played around and experienced the difference 100 micron can make to the first layer of a print, you'll probably agree that that is too much. Now of course a more precise sensor can still have those measurements that are far off, but it's much less likely to happen. So if you look at the measured standard deviations of the sensors I've tested, I'd say they are all very usable. Maybe with the exception of the sharp sensor and the capacitive one, everything else is like really good. Out of those, the BL Touch performed the worst, but if you take it a bit slower, it's still way more than good enough. So yeah, that's the story behind all the different sensor options. What surprised me was how precise the inductive sensors turned out to be. I was expecting them to be much noisier. What I'd also like to retest is the sharp sensor. This one is the analog type, but they are also making ones that just trigger at a set distance, and I think that might make it a bit less noisy too. This video was sponsored by Alive Objects Inc., a free software Libre innovation and open source hardware company headquartered in Loveland, Colorado, USA, and makers of the Loadspot desktop 3D printers. Watch my reviews of both Loadspot 3D printers here and check the links in the video description for more info on the machines straight from Alive Objects. So if this video was helpful to you, give it a thumbs up. If not, leave a comment on what I can improve. Also consider subscribing to the channel and click that bell or YouTube might not show you updates as new videos come out and live streams go live. Or head over to Patreon to support the channel directly and get access to monthly Q&A hangouts and more. And that's it for today. Thanks for watching and I'll see you in the next one.